Blackstone Audio presents The War to End All Wars, The American Military Experience in World War I, by Edward M. Coffman, read by Tom Weiner.
Prologue. Vive les Américains! The shouts rang out in competition with the marching airs of an army band. Parisians, perhaps a million in all, crowded the streets and pressed against the gendarme lines. Many of the women wore black, and except for some soldiers on leave, there was a notable absence of young men in the throng. The focus of this enthusiasm on July 4, 1917, was the first contingent of the American Expeditionary Forces to appear in Paris. The 16th Infantry's 2nd Battalion had arrived the day before from the port of Saint-Nazaire, and now they were showing the flag. From Napoleon's tomb at the Invalides to Lafayette's grave at Picpus Cemetery, they attempted to march, while flowers showered on them and emotional men and women embraced and kissed them. Most soldiers in their peaked campaign hats were regulars by name, but not by training. The commander of Company F, Sidney C. Graves, recalled, "The officers were afraid of the showing we might make since we had so many recruits. These men couldn't even slope arms. They were even more dangerous with a loaded rifle. But they were tall, bronzed, and above all, uncontaminated by life in the trenches." A French veteran looked them over and commented to an American reporter, "As human beings and raw material, they're the very best, but they need a deal of training. The hardest thing to teach them is not to be too brave. They must learn first to hide. That's the first essential in this war." Later, John J. Pershing, their commander, who knew that some two-thirds of this unit were recruits, told a diplomat, "Yes, the boys looked and marched all right, but I cannot tell what would have happened if more had been required of them." At their destination in Picpus Cemetery, there was some old-fashioned 4th of July oratory with a quartermaster lieutenant colonel, C.E. Stanton, hitting the keynote. "Lafayette, we are here." Across the Atlantic, the New York Times summed up the occasion. "The old debt is being paid." Chapter 1. The Coming of the War. The war that these Americans were entering, amidst so much celebration, was the disastrous culmination of a century of diplomatic maneuvering. European nations, in playing the game of power, had worked themselves into increasingly inflexible positions. Threats and counter-threats, advances and retreats in diplomacy and propaganda, had sustained the combustible situation during the first years of the 20th century. The assassination of the Habsburg heir in Sarajevo in 1914 broke the suspense and supplied the necessary momentum for catastrophe. By the spring of 1917, the belligerents had settled into a pattern of war that was quite rigid in nature and unimaginative in practice. The initial campaigns had sputtered out, and so ended the hopes of quick victory. On the Western Front, which stretched through northern France and Belgium, from Switzerland to the English Channel some 470 miles away, a trench stalemate entrapped two large armies. Lengthy artillery barrages initiated attacks and churned ground into an almost impassable barrenness. Then, men charged against machine guns, with predictable results. On other fronts, in the East and in Asia Minor, battles raged in a more fluid manner, but the Western Front, the focus of French and British activity on the Allied side, was a destructive deadlock. When the American battalion paraded in Paris, the stalemate on the Western Front was well into its third year. For years, Americans had watched warily as the European leaders constructed their alliances and fenced diplomatically. True, Theodore Roosevelt had barged into European affairs on occasion, but then TR was unique. Yet despite the ocean barrier, the United States was deeply involved, economically and culturally, with Western Europe. Then, too, with its bid for colonies, this nation had become entangled on the periphery of the power struggle. Indeed, in 1898, the friendliness of the British naval contingent toward the American fleet, in contrast with the attitude of the Germans in Manila Bay, was more than a casual illustration of national relationships. When it became apparent that there would be no quick victory in 1914, American resources were a strategic factor which belligerent planners had to consider. In any consideration, the degree of American neutrality and the interpretation of neutrality itself were crucial. Almost from the first, the United States demonstrated a predominantly pro-ally bias. The ruthless German invasion of Belgium, which callously disregarded not only neutral rights but existing treaties, British control of the seas, which funneled American trade to the Allies, the huge loans which Americans had extended to the Allies, a skillful British propaganda campaign, enhanced by control of the transatlantic cable. They had cut the German cable. The bungling of various Central Powers agents and the brutality of submarine warfare, which seemed to vivify Allied propaganda.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.